Okay, I'd like to welcome you to what is always a very important part of the Social History Conference, plenary lecture where we ask someone who's doing new, exciting, innovative work to come and enthuse us about their work. And the chair every year gets the chance to be involved in choosing that person. And I'm really pleased to be able to introduce to you someone who I'm sure you know, but you know how the convention is. I need to tell you about somebody that you know. So I will do that. So Steve Hindle is going to give us a lecture on space, community and economy in early modern rural England. So Steve, as you probably know, is the director of research at the Huntington Library in San Marino, California. Some of you may have been there to do research. And before that, he worked for many years at Warwick University. So you probably know his books, his important books, The State and Social Change in Early Modern England, published in 2000, and On the Parish in 2004. And he recently edited a festschrift for Keith Wrightson called Remaking English Society. You've probably read his important articles. And I think what's important for us to think about today is the kind of aspects of his work that will enrich the kinds of discussions that we've been having at Social History. He's working at the moment intensively, he says. I always like to hear that. Yeah. We like to know that our leading scholars are working intensively on the social topography of the Warwickshire parish of Chilvers Cotton. Is that how you pronounce it?
Coton.
Coton, okay. In the late 17th century. So you need someone resident in California to tell you how to pronounce English names. One of the things that touched me when we were just talking before about introducing him is that Steve remembers fondly that he was part of the first edition of Cultural and Social History, way back.
First article in the first issue.
So, I mean, you know, if there isn't a T-shirt for that, there ought to be. So, I mean, all of those things qualify him to, I think, give us a very interesting, exciting afternoon. So, space, community and economy in early modern rural England. Steve.
Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much for that warm introduction and a warm Lancastrian welcome. As a native of this county, I'm particularly pleased that this anniversary meeting of the Social History Society is meeting at Lancaster. I am, as Karen pointed out, director of research at the Huntington Library, where my position is endowed by the Keck Foundation, who also supports the televisual activities of both The Muppets and Sesame Street. But please don't let that put you off. I'm also particularly grateful to be here. Despite my jet lag, my blood sugar levels are oscillating wildly at the moment, a tendency that was probably only slightly mitigated by my successful desire to hike up Great Gable yesterday. So being back in the northwest of England gave me the opportunity to do one of the things that I love most of all. The historical study of the English rural community enjoyed its heyday in the 1970s and 80s. But its influence in the field of social and cultural history still resonates. Reaching its high water mark in 1979 with the publication of Keith Wrightson and David Levine's Poverty and Piety in an English Village, Tarling, 1525 to 1700, this trend in the scholarship paralleled work that was being undertaken in the context of New England by John Demos and others in the United States, and of Germany by David Sabean. In the English case, the influence of the Tarling study, as it became known, was particularly enormous, largely because Wrightson built its findings into his masterful creative synthesis of the new social history of early modern England, which appeared as English Society in 1982. While there was some skepticism, shared, of course, by the author himself, that Essex, still less Tarling, could be taken for all England, so much of what we now take for granted as standard elements or standard themes in the historiography, that is to say, economic differentiation, social polarisation, stratified cultural diffusion, the growing incorporation of the local community into the developing nation state. All these were conceptualised and verified in the context of one Essex village whose population never reached more than 600 individuals in the early modern period. By the time that the Tarling study was reprinted with a new postscript in 1995, the moment had passed, and fewer community studies have been attempted since. This is, to some extent, paradoxical, since the availability of vastly increased computing power and ever more sophisticated database analysis makes the kind of nominal record linkage that is so crucial to that kind of project rather easier than it was in the days of slips of paper and punch cards. The fate of Alan McFarlane's never completed study of Earl's Colne has become a salutary warning. Floating in cyberspace as a database of vast, not to say intimidating, proportions and remarkable discoverability, the material for this one English village was so extensive that the challenge of analysing it and writing it up was beyond even a historian of Alan McFarlane's extraordinary skill and imagination. At the same time, the methodological shift from social to cultural history, about which I, Alex Shepherd, and John Walter wrote at some length in the introduction to the Festschrift for Keith Wrightson that Karen just mentioned, presented students of the local community with other options for the reconstruction of social relations. From the perspective of the early 21st century, then, it is clear that the student who is ambitious or reckless enough to rise to the challenge of undertaking the reconstruction of a particular community enjoys the luxury, or is it a dilemma, of being able to choose from a number of paradigms which have been used over the years by historians who have come to regard themselves, following David Sabian, himself quoting the cultural anthropologist Clifford Geertz, less as students of villages rather than students in villages. And these three paradigms are, first, the German tradition of Alltagsgeschichte, the history of everyday life, often conducted through the painstaking analysis of the material evidence of economic transactions, paying particular attention to the incidental details disclosed by reading against the grain of the sources generated by the markets for land and of labour. Second, and perhaps more familiar to you, the Italian tradition, often described as anthropological, but in its original Ginsbergian formulation, having much more in common with detective fiction, of microhistoria, microhistory, in which the scale of historical observation is narrowed to make visible not only the most intimate details of interpersonal relationships, but also to allow the historian both to interrogate self-consciously the obvious strengths of and the even more obvious gaps in the historical record, and to tell stories about how stories were told. And third, the Anglophone and Anglophile tradition of local history, not in the antiquarian and often elegiac sense of parish history, but rather in the sense of the community study, theorised by Alan McFarlane himself in 1977, informed as it is by the kind of empirical sociology which uses intensive and often systematic nominal record linkage and network analysis to trace in one particular and particularised context the pattern of human interaction across and between a wide range of archival sources. Now, there are, to be sure, tensions between these various approaches to the historical reconstruction of local communities. And even if there were not, each of these paradigms has, in any case, inspired very significant historiographical controversy about their merits and defects, not the least of which concerns the relationship between the particular and the general. It is worth emphasising at the outset and repeating throughout that one village cannot be made to stand for all England, and that it is not my intention any more than it was the intention of the other practitioners of the community study, to mistake the part for the whole. Most local studies, in fact, imply what might be regarded as a minimalist claim for the typicality or representativeness of the particular community which happens to be under the lens of the historical microscope. The village in question is merely, in the terms of the micro-historical paradox, famously, perhaps even notoriously, formulated by Eduardo Grandi, a normal exception, or an exceptional norm. That is to say, it is exceptional only to the extent that it is so richly documented. It represents one variant of an experience which was arguably widely shared across much of rural England. And that's the local historian's attempt to have his cake and eat it. So in what follows, I want to present some preliminary and some not so preliminary findings from my long-standing project entitled The Social Topography of a Rural Community, which is designed to reconstruct the pattern of spatial, social, and economic relationships in one particular, but extraordinarily well-documented, English village in the late 17th century. Methodologically, the project sits at the intersection, some would say in the interstices, of the three methodologies I have already mentioned. That is to say, it is one part Alltagsgeschichte, one part microhistory, and one part community study. It has, as we shall see, one other special and highly distinctive ingredient, the survival of a really quite remarkable map, which has encouraged my project to take a spatial turn. So whether this mixture comes together to form a cocktail that you would actually want to taste is a moot point. That's a kind of Californian metaphor, really. But if you do, you will also join me in drinking somewhat poignantly to the memory of a village that, to all intents and purposes, no longer exists. For between them, the Victorian railway engineers, the Luftwaffe, and the Thatcherite annihilation of the coal industry destroyed virtually all the material and architectural evidence of its 17th century past. In offering this material to you, I hope both to demonstrate the intrinsic interest of writing and reading social history on this scale, but also to share with you my methodological anxieties about that very project. The village in question here, Chilvers Coton, pronounced Coton, had a population of 780 individuals divided between 176 households in the 1680s and was to that extent slightly more populous than most rural settlements in the Midlands. Just to orientate you here, to the northeast on this slide, we've got the urban settlement of Nuneaton. Immediately to its southwest is the village of Chilvers Coton, with Cuttle Mill, of which you will hear more in a moment. Here, the parish church immediately to the west, and then the village straggling both south and west towards the Heath End. In the far southwest of the parish is the ginormous manorial seat of the Newdigate family at Arbury Hall. I'd like you to notice this line running broadly south through the community. That's the Warwickshire coal seam. And that existence of the Warwickshire coal seam is of particular significance for this study. The type of mining that can be practiced here is problematic. It's neither open cast nor shaft mining. The technique is known as longwall mining, which involves the sinking of diagonal shafts into the pit. And that needs specialist kind of labour. We are here about as far away from the sea as it is possible to get in England. This is the kind of place that Jonathan Bate calls deep England. On this scale, Coventry would be somewhere down there, probably, and that explains why the Luftwaffe did its worst in the 1940s, because they were looking for Coventry munitions factories when they bombed the hell out of this particular village. Chilvers Coton was part of the Newdigate estate at Arbury Hall, near Nuneaton, in northeast Warwickshire. an environment very well known to literary scholars because it was, in 1819, the birthplace and subsequently the setting for several of the novels of George Eliot, whose Scenes of Clerical Life, published in 1857, is set in Shepperton, a thinly fictionalised version of Chilvers Coton itself. So this is Arbury Hall as it was engraved by the engineer Henry Beighton in 1708. Nothing of this building survives now because the Newdigate family subsequently Gothicised it. The only extant part of the estate is this building here, which looks like a manor house in its own right, but is in fact Sir Richard Newdigate's stable block. And if you have a love of horses as intense as Richard Newdigate's, there's only one man you would employ to be the architect of your stable block, and that's Christopher Wren. So this is, in fact, a Christopher Wren-designed stable block. As will become clear, I know so much about the inhabitants of this particular village that I am reasonably sure I can give you the name, age, and parentage of the coachman who is driving this particular coach. That may or may not be a good thing. The failed political ambitions of the landlord at Arbury, Sir Richard, 2nd Baron Newdigate, born 1644, died 1710, left him from the late 1670s onwards with too much time and energy on his hands. He's the worst type of control freak in that extent. And the following years, he embarked on a relentless and systematic programme of estate management, culminating in 1684 in a massive five-volume survey of his manors. In many respects, the survey was entirely traditional. It inventoried the perambulation of the manorial bounds, measured and evaluated landed, mineral and agricultural resources, listed the tenancies and their terms, rehearsed the customs and pains through which the common fields were regulated, and specified the origins of the landlord's title. So far, so conventional. Such sources have been widely used by economic historians to analyse the economic rationality of communal agriculture, and in particular to make the case for the very often profitable uses of waste, as Jeanette Neeson described them. But in the final two interrogatories administered to his court of survey, Newdigate asked questions which render the Chilvers Coton manorial archive particularly valuable for the reconstruction of social and economic and even spatial relationships. First, he required the head of each household to give the names, ages and occupations of each resident, including servants and apprentices, as well as kin. And it's very dark on this slide, but you've got here the first 16 of the 176 entries in the occupational census type listing of 1684. In each case, you've got a household: Henry Clay, number one; Widow Hinman, number two; Michael Payne, number three. And each case within them, the name: Henry Clay, Miller, age 41, Elizabeth, his wife, age 40. Five children, all names given, each of their ages given, and then three others, each of them a servant, and each of them with their names. And so on, for 176 households in the village. And second, he asked the churchwardens to identify the occupants of each pew in the parish church. And here, of course, there are similarities with Richard Gough's famous narrative strategy in reconstructing the history of the Shropshire parish of Middle. So this is my digitised version of the Childers Coton pew plan from 1684. The first of these sources alone is remarkable, since only two dozen of the 9,000 plus parishes in England have detailed 17th century occupational data of the kind preserved in this census type listing. The second type of record, the pew plan, more commonly survives in the judicial archives of church and state, but is nonetheless an invaluable supplement to the first. More remarkable still, there was a very significant cartographic element to Newdigate's survey. He instructed his surveyor, one Thomas Hewitt, to draw very detailed maps of the parish of Chilvers Coton and the manor of Arbury, which lay at its heart. And even more astonishingly, he required him to indicate on the map the precise whereabouts of each of the households listed in the survey. Of the 20 or so early modern English villages for which census type listings survive, Chilvers Coton is the only one with an accompanying map. So this is why my project is so unique. you can probably just about make out the main street of the village straggling westwards on this orientation and southwards into Griff here. You may just be able to see that some of the households have roofs that are coloured red by the cartographer, indicating that they were tiled rather than thatched. If you were standing where I'm standing, you could also see that the various tenements extend backwards into strips in the three great common fields of the parish. This is an open field village which isn't enclosed until 1784. Uniquely, therefore, it is possible to identify not only who did what for a living in this village, but also who lived with and next door to whom, and indeed, who sat next to whom in the parish church. Insofar as the practice of neighbourliness literally depended on residential propinquity, and that's itself a moot point, of course, the potential of this combination of sources immediately becomes apparent. It is effectively possible to take a tour of Chilvers Coton, walking in the footsteps of Thomas Hewitt and of the manorial jurors as they went from door to door for each of the 176 households in the village. And in some cases, it is even possible to cross that threshold, the doorstep itself becoming not just liminal, but permeable space. The enormously rich probate archive, which Chilvers Coton shares with so many other local communities in this period, means that any individual dying with personal property worth more than £5 was likely to have their material goods inventoried. Most probate inventories itemise movables room by room and describe material assets in sufficient detail to identify consumer goods and to distinguish them from working tools or farming stock. At least 30 of the households in Chilvers Coton generated extant probate inventories which survived from the period close enough to the date of the census, 1684, to be able to correlate the testator with a resident identified in the survey. And this one, the probate inventory of the widow Frances Raisin, taken on June the 6th, 1685, is the closest in date to the actual date of the census, which is December 1684. I've chosen this one in light of the very interesting discussion in the panel this morning about alehouses and alehouse inventories, because Frances Raisin, as we'll see, is the alehouse keeper in the village of Chilvers Coton. And this is a very, very detailed inventory of a 17th century alehouse. As you might expect, I know where the alehouse was. Household number 27, Frances Raisin, widow, is a very complex household because there are a number of different forms of house family type gathered under the one roof. Basil Raisin, labourer, household 28, co-resident, but Thomas Whitmore, silk weaver, also resident in that building with his young family. This alehouse had been licensed by the Warwickshire Justices since the 1650s. Frances Raisin had been widowed in the early 1680s and retained the licence herself. So we can not only knock on the door of many of these households, but enter the domestic space itself, inspecting the bed chambers, the parlours and the butteries, noticing whether cooking utensils were wooden or pewter, wondering about the origin of the silk which was being woven into ribbons on so many looms, speculating whether dairy goods were being produced merely for self-provisioning or for the local and regional markets for butter and cheese, and envying the feather pillows, looking glasses, curtains and clocks which distinguished the homes of the more affluent from their less prosperous neighbours. As an aside, it should be added that the relevant, that is to say directly contemporaneous to the 1680s, archives for Chilvers Coton are even more extensive than even this exciting combination suggests. And they include a very significant body of testimonial material generated by witnesses who gave evidence in the courts of church and state, remarkably detailed wage books for both the Arbury agricultural estate and the coal mines in the southern part of the parish, voluminous account books for the Arbury household itself, a reasonably good but by no means perfect run of parish registers of baptisms, marriages and burials, Sir Richard Newdigate's own journal, And, this is the killer, his library of some 270 items, ranging from the earliest editions of the classic texts of humanist discourse, including Thomas More's Utopia, through the printed ephemera characteristic of a society increasingly obsessed with burgeoning news media. The entire collection of Newdigate's books was purchased by Henry E. Huntington in 1920. So it is now all downstairs from my office in the Munger Research Centre at the Huntington Library. After all, where else would it be? Let's face it, if you're going to study Chilvers Coton, for God's sake, do it from Southern California. Don't do it from Coventry. So we can see what Richard Newdigate was reading in the early 1680s at the same time as he's actively involved in the manorial survey. This is his copy, 1626 edition, of Samuel Purchas's Pilgrimage, which is effectively a comparative historical geography of religion in global context. So the outside world is very much coming into the parish through the windows of Newdigate's study. He's also reading news sheets about various significant contemporary political events. He must have read this with some discomfort, the fate of the Rye House conspirators, who are hanged, drawn and quartered for treason in July 1683. Newdigate himself was tainted by association with the Rye House plot, so he must have been quaking in his boots when he was reading this. This rich array can be further supplemented because some of these archival sources, especially the probate material and the parish registers, extend forwards and backwards from the centre point of 1684, making it possible in at least some cases, don't mean to distract you, to construct a narrative of social, economic and cultural change through a time series rather than merely constructing a cross-section of social, cultural and economic relationships. Now, this material obviously poses challenges for a researcher with only one lifetime to fulfil his or her scholarly ambitions. It would be easy, but perhaps not desirable, to imagine spending the rest of one's scholarly career working on a village of less than 800 people. And I'll leave it to you whether you think that's a good idea or not. It is also, of course, difficult to keep so substantial a body of material under control, especially when so much of the analysis can be conducted only by linking forwards and backwards between various parts of the archive. But taking all this together, I need to try and demonstrate to you the potential of what I've got. Oh, there you go. So this is the eastern end of the parish of Chilvers Coton. I've already mentioned Henry Clay Miller in household number one, the churchyard a few hundred yards to the west, then the vicarage. I can literally take you on a guided tour of the village, following in the footsteps of the surveyors. In each case, being able to identify who was what doing what for a living, noticing the clustering of occupations, and we'll come back to that in a moment, noticing that there are a significant number of empty households, which is something of a significant finding. Usually when I first show this map, the mood of the room is, please, Steve, shut up and let's ask questions about the map. But I'm going to forgo that for the moment and take you through the potential of this kind of material. So that's the shape of the village as a whole in its digital form. Essentially, when the jurors and Thomas Hewitt did their perambulation, they walked this way and down here and back up there, that way, back that way, and then down here, and then up and round. Back. And then they go all the way up to the far north of the parish, which isn't on this scale, to the Northampton border, and back down this road and finish. The walk from Cuttle Mill to the Heath End at the far west end of the parish, taking in the southerly detours into Windmill Field and Paradise Lane, and then northwards to Wash Lane on the Nuneaton parish boundary and back home to the parish via the Sheep's Foot Inn, was perhaps 3 miles in total, and maybe another 4 or 5 miles of ground was traversed southwards into Griff and westwards through the Arbury Demesne and into the woodland. A party of middle-aged men might easily cover this territory in the course of a steady morning's walk. But the circumnavigation of the parish perforce took the jurors much longer than that, not least because their route march was less a matter of leisure than of labour. This was emphatically not a pleasantly aimless ramble. The jurors had been tasked with responding to the 21st article of Newdigate's survey to give an account of the names, ages and professions of every individual inhabitant. In meeting this obligation, they were therefore not simply walking past households and counting chimneys in the manner of the hearth tax assessors. Their responsibilities required much more of them, to stop at each house and to inquire of the occupants, presumably by asking the titular household head their names, ages and occupations. Since the initial household on the itinerary was his own, the juryman Henry Clay himself was the first to supply his fellow jurors with information of those who lived at Cuttle Mill. And this is the detail of the map that depicts Henry Clay's house, Cuttle Mill. You can see there is some attempt in each case by the surveyor to preserve some representational quality of the vernacular architecture of each building, distinguishing the number of bays, the number of windows, and in this case too, the number of chimneys. There were in total 10 of them in household number one. Clay himself, a miller, age 41, Elizabeth his wife, age 40, his children, Elizabeth aged 11, Mary aged 9, Henry aged 7, Martha aged 4, and Phoebe aged 1. And 3 other co-residents who were apparently not related to the Clays by blood or marriage. Anne Barefoot, a tabler or boarder, aged 32, John Waldron, a servant, aged 28, and Sarah Garrett, also a servant, age 21. Much more aesthetically pleasing is Riisdael's astonishing painting of a 17th century undershot water wheel. I think this is pretty much what Cuttle Mill will have looked like. And then the jurors moved on to the second household in the village, a quarter mile to the west, where Mary Hinman informed that she was a widow, age 54, and that her 2 sons, Thomas and George, aged 36 and 34 respectively, also lived in the house. Just next door, they discovered, resided Michael Payne, a 36-year-old labourer, together with his 30-year-old wife Jane and 2 children, Mary, age 14, and William, age 9, and so on, house by house and street by street, until they reached household number 176. Cumulatively then, the jurymen collected nominal, occupational and life cycle data for 780 individuals scattered across 176 households. These buildings ranged in size from the gargantuan Arbury Hall with its 37 residents, 28 of them servants, kind of the Downton Abbey of its day, to a dozen farms or cottages with only single person occupancy. 11 of the inhabitants of the village were aged 70 or more, and one of them claimed to be as old as 99. 17 of them, one of whom was only 6 weeks old, had yet to reach their first birthday. Their occupational designations clustered, as might be expected in a 17th century village, around the term labourer, of whom there were as many as 53. There were, moreover, 2 resident gentlemen, as well as 4 yeomen, 16 husbandmen, and the numerous artisans and craftsmen, blacksmiths, carpenters, masons, sawyers, shoemakers, and tailors, who provided the traditional village services. Less predictably, however, the professions amongst the inhabitants also included 15 colliers, 8 nailers, 7 rake makers, and 7 silk weavers, making ribbons. This is the origins of the Coventry ribbon manufacturing industry. Classically rural as it might at first seem, Chilvers Coton was nonetheless a community like Wickham, County Durham, gradually being turned inside out by industrialisation. Now, you can imagine that the historical demographers get very excited about this kind of data. And the historical demographers have indeed done a great deal of work on the Chilvers Coton occupational census type listing, and they've compared very extensively its age structure and its occupational structure with other villages in the community, in the country. There isn't time here, unfortunately, to rehearse that material in detail. It is nonetheless important for present purposes to note that this population is unusually young by national standards in terms of its age structure. There are also an unusually high proportion of orphans within it. But the appeal and interest of the Chilvers Coton census type listing to historians of society, economy and demography in early modern England becomes all the more obvious when it's remembered that the jurors were not the first to walk down these streets. They're following in the footsteps of the surveyor. It is in this context that one of the more laconic references in Sir Richard Newdigate's journal turns out to be one of the most interesting. On Wednesday, the 4th of October, 1682, Newdigate recorded that he looked o'er Mr. Hewitt's map of Coton town and fields. Indeed, Thomas Hewitt's maps of Chilvers Coton are arguably the jewel in the crown of the archive. There is, of course, nothing unusual in the mapping of estates, which had, by the late 17th century, become commonplace with the rise of the professional surveyor. And it was particularly significant at a time when landlords were engaged in the project of using maps to turn landscape into emptable space by means of enclosure. So by looking in detail, and you can see even more obviously at this scale, or perhaps not in this light, the vernacular architecture and these occupational designations, were able to follow the jurors of the court as they went from door to door. For perhaps the first time, therefore, analysis of the map in conjunction with the survey makes it possible to sort out the poorer sort of an English village, not only in conventional social structural terms, by measuring their income, their outgoings, and their material wealth, but also in spatial terms, by locating their cottages in the landscape, which yielded them their living. So in what follows, I want to demonstrate the potential of this material, first by analysing the spatial clustering of trades and occupations in Chilvers Coton, and subsequently by sketching what might be tentatively regarded as an emotional geography of the community. I'll conclude by sharing with you some of my methodological anxieties about the project. Particularly like this image, because you can see the church and the adjacent vicarage. The vicarage looking something like a small manor house, and it's pretty clear that by 1684 the vicarage had become somewhat gentrified, as was the case in so many English villages in this period. As we've seen, Chilvers Coton was an industrialising community with an unusually high proportion of its labouring population engaged in manufacture of one kind or another. The village had, for instance, a small but significant cohort of silk weavers engaged in the manufacture of ribbons. Ranging in age between 25 and 60, at an average of 37, the seven silk weavers were scattered across the eastern end of the parish, three in Coton town, two of them living opposite each other on either side of Bridge Street, two in the Heath End, and two in Griff. And you can see the two silk weavers in the Heath End here, Edward Golby up there, and Francis Sargent, silk weaver, living just a few yards from one another. All except one lived in very modest dwellings and paid annual rents of less than £1. Only one of them had a tenancy of any size, occupying a large 62-acre holding with a seven-room farmhouse rented from Sir Richard Newdigate in the village of Griff, in which the chamber over the kitchen contained two silk looms, a warping bar, and other odd things belonging to the silk weaving trade. The presence in the Nuneaton area of the Warwickshire coal seam made the recruitment and accommodation of colliers particularly desirable. There were 15 colliers listed in the census, ranging in age from 30 to 62 at a mean of 47. Again, they were clustered in the eastern end of the parish, but with two significant concentrations. Four of them in cottages on the common either side of Sea Lane, and you can see four of them here, and another five in modest tenements on the Wash Lane adjoining Nuneaton. I think this is particularly significant because these colliers are almost certainly housed by Newdigate on the common and given common rights as a way of making their residence particularly attractive and sustainable. 11 of the colliers paid rents of less than a pound a year, and 6 of them were tenants of Newdigate himself. One gets the sense that he's actively recruiting coal mining labour. Only 2 had holdings of more than the statutory 4 acres. One on the northern side of Sea Lane held 7 acres at a rent of £4 a year, and another on the northern side of Sea Lane held 8 acres at a rent of 3 shillings and 4 pence, even though this dwelling had been exempted from the hearth tax a decade previously. 2 of them were dependent on parish relief by the end of the decade, and 2 others lived long enough to give depositions in Chancery over 30 years later. There were 8 nail makers in Childers Coton in 1684, ranging in age between 20 and 82 at an average of 46. 4 of them lived within the space of 30 yards of each other on the north side of Bridge Street. You can see them here. And a 5th a quarter of a mile to the south on the Windmill Lane. 2 others lived in the Heath End, one at the Bode Lane crossroads and another in Paradise Lane, while the 8th lived much further south in Griff. 6th of them lived in one hearth cottages, 3 of which had been assessed on forges, as you might expect, in the 1674 hearth tax. Only 2 of them paid rent of more than a pound a year, and some indication of the material circumstances is given in the probate inventory of one of them, who died poor and in debt in 1696 at the age of 46, by then living in a 3-room cottage containing a house, a chamber and a workshop, and supporting himself with a small number of livestock. Only 4 of the 8 lived long enough to witness the tumults of the West Midland Nailmakers' Strike of 1697, which Newdigate himself had a hand in suppressing, though whether they were amongst the protagonists is unclear. There were 7 rake makers in the village, a skill in high demand because the tools they produced were necessarily for the riddling of coal, an activity carried out by both men and by women. Aged between 24 and 46, with an average age of 36, 5 of them lived within 100 yards of each other, either side of Windmill Field Lane in Coton Town, and 2 others on the Bode Lane, either side of the Heath End. They seem to have been moderately more prosperous than the nail makers, although only 1 had a middling-sized holding of 34 acres. The remainder lived in modest one-hearth cottages with a couple of acres of home stall, if they were lucky. The trade seems to have run in one particular family, the 2 Wagsters, you can see them here. George Sr. and his son, also George, lived and worked in cottages backing onto Windmill Field, only 50 yards apart. And 2 other Wagsters, both called William, and probably cousins of one George Wagster or the other, were also described as rake makers living yards apart in Bode Lane. And you can see here the potential of nominal record linkage between the census and the parish registers, locating them with the map. You start to see the spatial distribution of occupations, but also the spatial distribution of kin. In some respects, the mapping exercise made possible by the linking of these sources is not just an economic, but an imaginative or cultural one. And this is the part of the project which really trips my trigger. The sources create a palpable sense of the spatial distribution of emotion, and especially of joy, anxiety, and grief, as we follow the jurors through the parish. Demographers might not be surprised to learn that in a parish of 780 inhabitants, there were as many as 24 baptisms in 1684. But they might find it more surprising that these births were scattered across 14% of the households in the parish. The cries of infants could likely be heard from the doorsteps of 1 in every 7 of the households on which the jurors stood. But never before has it been possible to identify what must have been a cacophony of bawling children across 6 households within a 100-yard radius of the bullring at the heart of the village. Between late January and early November 1684, the Coopers, the Floyds, the Kinders, the Paynes, the Raisins and the Whitmores all baptised children in the parish church of All Saints, and their offspring doubtless caused sleepless nights for parents and neighbours alike in Bridge Street and Windmill Field Lane over the next year or so. You can tell I'm the father of 3 children, I'm sure. 3 of the new arrivals were literally next door to one another on the south side of the row. In the houses of the labourer, Basil Raisin, who already had 2 older children, the silk weaver, Thomas Whitmore, who had 1 older child, and the rake maker, Richard Floyd, 2 older children. There were another cluster of newborns 100 yards to the west, where the Suffolks, the Shaws, the Freestons and the Browns, who lived in 4 adjacent cottages on Sea Lane, had also baptised children in the year before the census was taken. Robert Suffolk, Elizabeth Shaw and Anne Brown, like Margaret Whitmore and Anne Floyd, doubtless looked up to and learned from their older siblings in years to come, but they almost certainly enjoyed rough and tumble with their playmates next door. Alice Freestones and Margaret Whitmore is in household number 29, were not so lucky. Poor Margaret survived less than a month. Worse still, this was a case of maternal morbidity, for Elizabeth Whitmore survived her infant daughter by only 2 days, and the poignancy of Thomas Whitmore's catastrophic bereavement can only have been rendered more acute by the presence in adjacent households of healthy babies more fortunate than his own. Widowed with a year-old daughter, Thomas was by December 1684 living with his mother-in-law, herself already widowed. Perhaps both were consoled not only by the antics of the surviving toddler, named Elizabeth, after her mother, but by the sympathetic gesture made by his neighbours, the Raisins, who less than 4 months after Thomas Whitmore had buried his wife and child, chose to christen their daughter Margaret, almost certainly in memory of the baby girl who'd so briefly lived next door. The consolation was, more sadly still, short-lived, for Margaret herself succumbed in February 1687, not long after her second birthday. The joy of parenthood, then, was tempered with grief and sometimes with anguish, and the jurors must have been conscious of the losses recently incurred in so many households across the parish. At least 35 burials had taken place at All Saints in the year before the census was taken, and the overwhelming majority of those who passed away must have been known to the jurors. Robert Smith, a stranger boarding at Cornelius Carver's house in the Wash Lane on the parish boundary with Nuneaton, is the exception that proves the rule. It's interesting that that house is so very close to the parish boundary and that the stranger dies virtually on the parish boundary. At least five of the deceased, those who died in 1684, were widows, who by definition left no trace in the census. But 21 of those who died can plausibly be linked to specific households in the listing. That a large number, 26, or 1 in 7 of the households in the parish should have been headed by widows should come as little surprise. And that so many of them, 5, should have been bereaved over the course of the previous year might be expected. Their coping strategies remain in many respects obscure, though of course there's been a great deal of work being done in recent years on the support strategies and networks that survive, that exist and are developed amongst elderly single women. Thomas Hewitt's maps provide some clues of mutual support on the basis of their residential propinquity. 5 of the 7 houses in a row at the western end of Wash Lane, for example, were occupied by widows. 62-year-old Lou Staples, 60-year-old Anne Freestones, 40-year-old Anne Cox, and 60-year-old Anne Knock lived within 30 yards of each other. Staples, Freestones, and Cox lived with their daughters and or grandchildren, but Knock lived alone. Staples had been widowed only a month, but she doubtless benefited from the emotional support provided by her neighbours, each of whom had been bereaved at least 13 years before. There was another cluster of widows at the intersection of Sea Lane and Bode Lane, where the 4 households headed by the widows Anne White, 62 years old, widowed since God knows when, Alice Burgess, aged 40 and widowed since 1679, Sarah Starkey, aged 67, widowed less than 2 years, and Anne Hammersley, aged 62, widowed less than a year, faced each other across the crossroads. While Starkey lived with her grandchildren, Burgess with her son, and Hammersley with a servant, White lived alone, perhaps depending for support on her married niece, who lived next door. If there was compassion, there was also courtship. Though we might, of course, debate whether marriage formation was a function of effective individualism or more pragmatic material considerations. Several couples can be proved to have been courting in the parish at the time that the census was taken, and over the next year, at least 6 of these relationships were solemnised at All Saints Church. Only 2 of the marriages were, however, entirely endogamous to the parish of Chilverscoton. John Shaw, the 18-year-old son of a silk weaver living on Sea Lane was to marry 19-year-old Anne Sargent, the daughter of a sawyer living a quarter of a mile to the west in the Heath End. While the 31-year-old Richard Holmes, son of a nail maker and living with his widowed father in a cottage in Griff, was to marry 25-year-old Elizabeth Slingsby, the daughter of a mason, living a mile to the west in the Arbury woodland. Of the four couples most recently wedded at All Saints during the course of 1684, three had in fact settled in the parish, but it is striking that only one of them, significantly the one where the married partners were significantly older than the others, had either the desire or the wherewithal to form nuclear family households of their own. 45-year-old labourer Nicholas Payne and his 42-year-old wife Alice settled in a very small farm in the woodland, only a stone's throw from the farmhouse inhabited by her parents and two sisters. Two other couples were not so independent, though in each case the groom's reasons for cohabiting with his mother-in-law were doubtless different. The 32-year-old cobbler Richard Wardle and his 21-year-old bride Elizabeth lived with her widowed mother and three siblings in a very substantial 8-room house recently built on the south side of the Arbury domain. 23-year-old silk weaver Thomas Knight and his 22-year-old bride, by contrast, lived with their 6-week-old baby daughter and her widowed mother in a small tenement at the extreme west of the Heath End. None of these courting or recently married couples were fortunate enough to baptise children in the year or so after the census was taken, though we can be very confident that sexual activity was taking place in, or indeed around, a number of other households at about the time that the jurors were perambulating. Yes, I'm trying to reconstruct where people were having sex in a late 17th century village. At least three couples conceived and enjoyed pregnancies that went to full term over the next 9 months. The 28-year-old husbandman Henry Baker and his wife Mary already had two older children at the time she fell pregnant in their cottage on the Windmill Field Lane. And the 20-year-old tailor William Cox and his bride Mary had a resident apprentice when she conceived in a little cottage on the Wash Lane, which they shared with his mother. Only the 37-year-old yeoman William Jakes and his wife Mary, who lived in a house large enough to accommodate three older children and six resident servants, had the room which might have afforded their intimacies some privacy. But even in affluent circumstances such as theirs, it was doubtless difficult to keep sexual activity from the prying eyes and sensitive ears of domestic staff. Some households were doubtless permeated with the whiff of scandal. There was only one illegitimate child identified in the census, 3-year-old Anne Ierson, living with her widowed mother in a one-hearth cottage on the row north of Bridge Street, across the way from the village alehouse, and two doors down from her respectably married sister. Whether the child was accepted and her mother forgiven her indiscretion is unclear, but in the absence of a putative father and a paternity bond, Anne's life chances as a bastard were not great, as the fate of the only other illegitimate in the parish, 23-year-old Anne Chaplin, who lived in the village almshouse, suggests. Anne Ierson did not live long enough to share her namesake's fate, since she died at the age of 7 in 1689, though by that time the parish officers had boarded her out in a collier's cottage half a mile to the west in the Heath End. Endemic disorder was, however, associated with another particular house in the village. The one-hearth cottage on the west side of Paradise Lane, south of the Heath End, was the home of the 38-year-old labourer Richard Archer, scion of a family whose reputation for delinquency was of long standing. Richard's father, William, had been presented in 1652 as a fearful swearer and blasphemer, guilty of uttering 21 profane oaths within the space of 4 days, and not only bound over to his good behaviour for 3 years, but fined the considerable sum of £3.10 to the use of the poor of the parish. One imagines there was a considerable degree of alcohol involved in that particular episode. How long Richard Archer, shown here, had been settled in Paradise Lane is unclear, though he apparently cohabited with his much older common law wife, Anne. He was repeatedly in trouble, and not only for living in sin. He was indicted for an assault on the wife of one of his neighbours in 1689 and presented, like his father, as a profane swearer and curser. Suspect reputation obviously ran in the family, but it may also have been associated in the popular mind with particular places and spaces in the cultural map of the community. Now, as I'm sure you could tell, I could go on and on and on and on. I am absolutely transfixed and excited by the possibility of this kind of nominal record linkage. Maybe you're interested, maybe you're not, but I'm anxious. Let me tell you why I'm anxious. I have a number of reservations about the project, which I want to share with you, and you can either set my mind at rest, or you can discourage me from pursuing this further. So first of all, there is the no comparator conundrum. There is no other 17th century village which is documented in quite the same way as Childers Coton. To be sure, we now have an impressive roster of community studies of villages, which have become standard reference points in the historiography of early modern England. We know a great deal, for instance, about poverty and piety in Tarling, Essex, about industrial development in Wickham, County Durham, about church seating arrangements in Middle, Shropshire, about the land market in Earl's Colne, Essex, about the historical demography of Colleton in Devon, about the development of the community at Highley in Shropshire, and so on. But none of the data sets that underpin these reconstructions are exactly analogous to that which can be reconstructed on the basis of the Newdigate's archive, and all of them conspicuously lack a cartographic and therefore a spatial dimension. Put particularly bluntly, Keith Wrightson and David Levine had no bloody idea where the paupers who constitute the heroes or victims of their narrative actually lived in the parish of Tarling. That really bothers me. While the absence of a comparator is not fatal to the project, since certain aspects of Childers Coton can be compared and contrasted with the features that characterised one or more of these villages, it is nonetheless troubling and begs questions about typicality and representativeness that can only be addressed by the circumspection of the normal exception hypothesis rather than convincingly answered. Secondly, there is the snapshot problem. I'm trained as a social historian and I prefer to think about change over time. But with a very few exceptions, and I've hinted at those exceptions in the course of the discussion, the material available to me for Childers Coton allows me to offer only a cross-sectional view through the village at one particular point in time, rather than a time series analysis of its development over decades, generations, or centuries. The attractions of retrospective cultural anthropology notwithstanding, I'm not sure that I can or would want to write an analysis of 1684, the year that changed the world, or at least changed Childers Coton. Third, the granularity paradox. One of the features that appeals to me most about this project is its enormously rich texture. The material is so rich that I know more about this village than anybody has ever known about any 17th century village, and arguably more about it than the people who lived in it. And, as I'm sure you can tell, I love the granularity of it. I delight in the possibility of offering you potted biographies of each of the 780 inhabitants. I've gone a good way towards doing just that this afternoon. I could certainly bear to tell you those stories, but I'm not sure that you would share my enthusiasm if you had to read or listen to them all. The urge to embrace my inner Cowsabon, to use an apposite Middle Marchian analogy, and write a million words about these people is strong. But it must, of course, be resisted. But how then to control and present the material while at the same time doing justice to the micro-sociologies that governed lived experience? Finally, at some level, the story has to be about the collectivity. Whether we would wish to call it a community is itself a moot point. How did these 780 individuals and the 176 households in which they lived come together to form a single political society? And how was that society fractured and reconstituted? How was its social fabric rent and repaired over time? We can see some examples of precisely that collectivity, especially in the perambulation of the parish bounds, in which a large proportion of the male inhabitants of the parish are expected to gather well into the 18th century. And most of the records we have of that records the names of those who perambulated, and they can be plausibly linked back to the census of 1684. But that question about the collectivity preoccupied Wrights and Levine in their study of Tarling, and was less self-consciously in play for David Hay, Gwyneth Nair, and the others to whose community studies I have referred. It was another way of responding to Peter Laslett's challenge of understanding ourselves in time. But it's the fundamental assumption of this project that to understand our ancestors in time, we must also understand them in space, to animate them in their daily interactions, the routes they would have walked to work, the neighbours they would have encountered on their doorsteps, the teams in which they laboured, the pews in which they huddled, the rooms in which their material goods were situated and stored. There is now a significant literature on the spatial turn in the humanities, and the work of Doreen Massey and Tim Ingold has been particularly influential in this regard. So the conceptualisation and representation of the spaces and places of Chilvers Coton is the most significant challenge in reconstructing its social topography. So I'll conclude with an invitation to participate in a methodological discussion. How do you think that conceptual and representational work can most effectively be carried out? Or is all this concern about 780 individuals in 176 households in one Warwickshire village simply a waste of space? Thank you. So I would be very happy to answer questions on the sole condition that we have a self-denying ordinance, right? So the self-denying ordinance is that nobody in this room says, Steve, you've got such great material. I know I've got such great material. It's not a compliment to me to hear that I've got such great material. The point is, what am I doing with it, and what should I be doing with it?
Okay.
Professor Sharp.
Professor Sharp, yes. Okay. Just to introduce by Steve, Jim Sharp, University of York. I've done a couple of much more shallow attempts at village reconstruction for specific purposes. And I think, like most people in the room, I would not dissuade you from carrying on with this. It's fantastic. I can understand your worries about obsession and so on. Two things. One is, on your doubts about continuing, the obvious point is that this type of work is cumulative. So, okay, you mentioned some of the other major village studies have been, as it were, you know, when Laslett was writing, 50 years ago now, this sort of work had barely been begun, and as you were saying again quite correctly, and as Karen was saying in the introduction, one of the big things has exploded has been this early modern social history, which 50 years ago nobody could have imagined. And I think that, you know, all of us who have participated in this to whatever level are appreciative of where this might lead. And it is cumulative, as I said, things will build up. The one thing I wanted to probe you on, which I think would, you know, possibly help me understand how you might get more of a development of this, because as you say, we should change be worried yeah. about change over time, is the other sources that you've got compared to this one that I'm not allowed to say is really great. I think Warwickshire quarter sessions records yep. that meet, sizes don't. Yep. You presumably got church court records.
The church court records are very poor, and it's very significant that Chilvers Coton cases are conspicuous by their absence.
Really?
And I suspect that's because the landlord is smothering up dispute reconciling it.
That again is an interesting thought. Related directly to that, have you got manorial records?
So I've got amazing manorial records.
Well, that I think could be a real key to
just,
you know, opening this up. And so I think that makes me even more reassured that you ought to be carrying on with this.
Okay, well, thank you. I have got serial runs of manorial records through the late 17th and early 18th century. As I've already hinted, the probate material is particularly strong. and it's possible to reconstruct the changing material culture of the village, either side of 1684, in some measure at least. So that's reasonably encouraging. But of course, what I'd really like to be able to do would be to have an occupational census type listing for 1608 and another one for 1768, and then to situate this one in that overarching pattern. So that's what makes me nervous. So much of what I can say about this village is specific only to a few months at the end of 1684.
Yeah, but one appreciates that, but there is a hell of a lot you're going to be able to say, and that is, you know, going to be opening things up. If you had a clergyman with a quarter of a million word diary, that might help as well.
Say that again.
If you had a clergyman with a quarter of a million word diary, that might help as well.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. Point taken.
Yeah. Okay, can we widen the discussion out between... So, Colin...
Colin Pooley, Lancaster. My question was actually similar in the sense that I was also wanted to sort of raise the issue about the cross-section that you've got.
Yeah.
And the small amount of work that I've done on similar sorts of communities suggests that people were swapping houses all the time, they were lending stock, they were swapping land, they were lending money. There was enormous amount of fluidity and change going on.
Yes.
So although it's great to have a really detailed cross-section, you have to be really careful about implying stability when actually what might be going on is an awful lot of change.
I think that's exactly right. And I do have some sources that allow me to get at that. Some of the quarter sessions material that Jim mentions allows me to reconstruct, for instance, the pattern, and Naomi Tadmore will be interested in this, I think, the pattern of settlement litigation in the village. And you can see how problematic the arrival of newcomers is and how determined the parish officers are to move them out. It's also very significant, I think, that so many of these houses are empty. There's clearly a body of housing stock, and to some extent, the landlord is rotating his tenants and employees through that housing stock as and when it suits him, and quite possibly also relocating specific individuals after certain types of demographic event. And it strikes me as really interesting that there are clusters of widows living in such residential proximity to one another. So I take the point entirely. Thank you.
The next question is from Penny, so could we pass a mic there? Can I, while it's being passed, let me ask a question and then, sorry. Emotional geographies.
Yes.
Really like the idea.
Yeah.
One of the things I was thinking about unequivocally not early modern historian that has come out of some of our work on researching networks and friendships between politically active women is that one of the things that people tend to do is that if people are in the same place at the same time, they assume friendship or at least sort of toleration of one another. Mm. And yet, when you look at private correspondence, it doesn't always survive. You sometimes find the, oh my God, you know, that damn woman, she spoke for hours and hours. Yeah. She grabbed my question when I was about to ask one. So why, I mean, taking that back to your emotional geographers, the notion that propinquity means neighbourliness and that is a kind of positive virtue. Any comment on that?
Yes, well, thank you for asking. I mean, I should emphasise one key point here. So my reconstruction of the emotional geography is not done in the same way that you might expect a cultural historian to do it. I don't have the depositional evidence which would allow me to read what one neighbour is saying about another. I don't have a body of defamation cases of the kind that Garthine Walker or Laura Gowing have worked on in the past. So, I hope it's pretty self-evident what I was doing. I was cross-referencing between certain types of sources and in imagining what kind of relationship. So, I mean, that very poignant case about the naming of one child after a neighbour's deceased child, that speaks volumes to me. Or perhaps I'm just being fanciful. I'm perfectly aware that better fences make better neighbours. And, you know, in previous work, I've worked, like many people in this room, on an enormous body of litigation which suggests that very often in a face-to-face society, dispute can get out of hand and traditional methods of dispute settlement are breaking down all the time. There's the phenomenon that we now call hyperlexis in the 17th century, the excessive use of litigation. So I don't necessarily assume that living next door to one another implies a certain quality of social relationship. And that's why I'm so tentative, I think, about this. Penny.
Well, I'm Penny Summerfield from the University of Manchester, another unequivocally not early modern historian. So as a 20th century historian with a great deal of interest in personal testimony, its uses by historians, particularly historians venturing into the field of the history of emotions.
Right.
I'm wondering, I mean, I'm sure you would have talked about any diaries or letters that there were for this village. Mm-hmm. You did mention Sir Richard Newdigate's journal,
yes.
So we might hear a bit about
yes,
that.
Sure.
But where I'm going really is, would it be sort of methodologically completely impossible for you to use diaries and letters and possibly fiction from outside this village in rather the way that Carolyn Steedman has done working in the late 18th century? I mean, she has used fiction to sort of fill in the structures of feeling,
right.
The kind of emotion that she's traced in other ways, using other kinds of sources which don't render the emotions.
No, thank you. That's a really excellent question. There are no diaries and correspondence, as you pointed out. I would have mentioned it had there been. Richard Newdigate's journal is very fragmentary. It survives only for a three-year period at the beginning of the 1680s, and it's on that basis I can work out exactly what he was reading, because he records in his journal which books he's pulling from the shelf and also which scriptural texts he's reading in his Bible reading as well. Other than that, it's pretty laconic. It's fairly clear that the family expurgated his journal after his death, partly because they're worried that there was stuff in there about the Rye House plot, which renders him very politically vulnerable. The literature thing is interesting, and it's all the more appealing because of the literary afterlife of the village, right? Scenes of clerical life is set here. So as I've, you can imagine there is a pinned to my office wall, there are about 19 different versions of the narrative structure of this book as I try and work out how best to present it. And one version does have a prologue to each chapter, which is from Scenes of Clerical Life, which speaks in so many ways to issues which are germane to this population. But in terms of what late 17th century fiction might look like that might allow me to illuminate it, I don't know. I mean, I'm a big fan of historical fiction. This village strikes me a lot like Adam Thorpe's Ulverton, frankly, if for those of you who've read that. Hi.
That's a question from Ben and then from Helen.
Okay. Thanks very much. You mentioned Tim Ingold at the end, which was welcome. So I was going to ask you a question about that.
Yeah.
I think I can see the way in which you're using perhaps some of his stuff about taskscapes and so on to draw out the emotional geography of this this area.
Yeah.
One of the other things that Ingold seems to be very keen on is the kind of materiality aspect and thinking about materiality in terms of the materials rather than the material objects. So I was just wondering if you could reflect on perhaps the materiality materials of the objects that you're studying in terms of their texts. And I suppose within that, to think about also the survey that you have as something which is a particular understanding and taskscape of this village. And that, so I suppose my worry is then that the survey in itself is an imagination, an emotional imagination of the village, which thus renders it exceptional in a particular way. So you couldn't possibly have this batch of sources if this village, that you know, that existence of it actually makes this village exceptional in ways that other villages might not.
Well, yes, I am on the latter point. I am sensitive to that possibility. The fact that he asks for names, ages, and professions, rather than names, ages, and occupations, for instance, there is some inconsistency in terms of the ways different types of individuals describe themselves, and also inconsistencies between the way they are described in their probate material and the way they are described in the census. So on the one hand, the census type listing is a lens which illuminates the village, but in other ways, it's a lens which powerfully distorts the image of the village. That said, it's a hell of a lot better than nothing. And without it, I wouldn't be doing any of this, of course. Ingold, I've been reading a lot of Ingold recently with a great deal of enthusiasm. I love his stuff on dwelling. I could tell you a great deal about the material culture of the consumer goods and working tools that are in each of these households. I'm also very interested in Anthony Buxton's recent thesis and just published book on which uses the methodology of proxemics to work out the relationship between various types of material good that sit adjacent to one another in particular rooms. I think that's particularly exciting. But do I take your question to refer to the materiality of the documents with which I'm working? Yes, yeah. So it's a massive 5-volume manorial survey that's engrossed on parchment and bound in leather. It's the archive of an authority figure, by definition. I am absolutely bloody determined to write the history of this village from the bottom up or from the inside out. I really don't want to look at this village through Sir Richard Newdigate's eyes. And you can see there's a whole series of ideological reasons, political reasons, why I might feel that way. So there's something of a sleight of hand that has to go on here. I need to rely on his archive, right? But I don't want to look at the village the way he would have wanted to look at it. Is that a fair answer? Oh, thank you.
Helen.
Hello, I'm Helen Rogers from Liverpool John Moores University.
Hello.
And I'd love the emotional cultural geography to work. I'm not sure that it can without, say, you know, court records. However, what you do have, which I think is fantastic, is the ability to bring the kind of spatial representation of the town with a kind of temporal information. And so you can kind of bring this village to life in that sort of snapshot period of time that you've got. But I've just been thinking, as you were talking, I was thinking about the work that the Early Modern Women's Work Project at Exeter, which Jane Whittle's leading, is doing, and the times that people get up in the day and when they go to bed, and all these different occupations will have, you know, it'll be seasonal patterns of work. And putting that together with the spatial thing, I think that's what could be really exciting about
this project. I agree with you wholeheartedly, and that's very much on my agenda. And you can imagine that that section of the talk this afternoon that dealt with the different occupational groups and where they were clustered. It is my intention to expand that out into an analysis of the working rhythms of those particular trades, and especially the relationship between those particular trades and agriculture, because of course this is an economy in which by-employments are very, very common. Something like 1/3 of all these households, irrespective of what the occupational designation of the head of household is, are working in Newdigate's coal mines. So you can imagine that the overlap and intersection of various types of economic activity is going to be very difficult to reconstruct. But I share your ambition to do that kind of work. Thank you.
And is there a digital humanities kind of edge to this?
Thank you.
Are you going to need that to be able to do this?
So the big methodological dilemma that I faced this summer is whether it will be worth the investment of my time, energy, and resources to introduce GIS to this.
Yes, I think is probably the answer
so
to that.
So I don't know. I've seen, without offending anybody in the room, there is some absolutely brilliant GIS stuff. Ian Gregory's GIS stuff is absolutely amazing. But I've seen a lot of really shoddy GIS presentation that really shows with a lot of pretty pictures stuff that you could already guess at. That said, I need to decide whether GIS would be helpful for analytical purposes or for presentational purposes or for both. My feeling at the moment is that I probably need it for analytical purposes.
Naomi, and then you.
Naomi Tadmore, Lancaster. With the absence of church records, your hands are tied to an extent, and that is a real limitation when it comes to household and family reconstitution, which would have been your basic way forward.
Right.
I wonder to what extent, and it is very reassuring to know that there are good sources relating to settlement that you may be able to plough. I wonder to what extent it might be useful to try and place this village in networks of migration. Because after all, most of the migratory patterns at that time, we would expect them to be over the short distance of up to 10 miles. Correct. We would expect them to be seasonal. We would expect great occurrence of marriage connections, surnames, and so on and so forth. And that might enable you to explain some of the typicalities or atypicalities of the village and at least create families and households perhaps in a thicker way. In terms of the issues that you presented, I think that it will help to throw light on what, to my mind, just seems striking and unusual, and that is the clustering of widows, which goes beyond, we would expect a lot of women not to remarry at that time. The fact that there are lots of widows living together doesn't surprise me, but the fact that they're clustered in this way just looks really odd. And also the way in which near-local residents and nuclear family residents don't seem to fit the profile. And from what I can see so far from my work in settlement, much of the nuclear residence is the result of intervention of settlement regulations.
I am delighted
so
to hear
it
that.
Might be yeah. that, in fact, what you're seeing is the mirror image of exactly the same thing.
Interesting. I do have a working paper on migration patterns, which is based both on the settlement analysis, the analysis of the settlement cases, but also on the marriage registers, which always record the parish of origin of the individual who is not a Chilvers Coton native. The furthest afield that any marriage partner comes from is 40 miles, and the average is between 5 and 10, as you might expect. That's an issue where I think the GIS representation of those patterns of that migration field would be useful. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Ellie Robson from the University of Cambridge, and I work on 17th century fenland drainage, but I'm very interested in surveying and surveys, and I wondered if you could talk a little bit more about what exactly the purpose of this survey was. You said that Nidicote had made it for purposes of estate management, and I think kind of returning to the document itself, what was the purpose, and do you have any evidence about how it was used? Because surveys didn't just reflect, they also transformed, and maybe that's one way to return to the question of social change is what actually was the survey doing right. in this context?
Right, thank you. That's a really excellent question. I can say a little bit about how the survey was used, because it's clear that Nudigat himself, over the remaining 20-odd years of his life, is actively returning to it and amending it as certain types of social, economic, and other relationship change. So to that extent, although it's fixed, as it were, for 1684, he regards it as a working document which he can amend as necessary. I, as you can imagine, I've really struggled to think through what his motives might have been. As I hinted in my introduction, to a certain extent, there's evidence that he's bored, that his ostracism from county society and from Westminster society, the political suspicions about his role in the exclusion crisis and the Rye House plot won't go away. His correspondence is very limited. His journal doesn't suggest that many people are coming to see him. So he's a very isolated figure, I think. So part of this thing must have been a diversion, a way of just using his time. And it's clear that he is very actively involved in it, in the process, and there's lots of evidence for that. The journal is replete with references to him doing specific stuff, either in conjunction with the jurors or not. There are two other possibilities. One possibility is that the correspondence that survives in the Newdig archive is very, very limited, but amongst his most regular correspondents is Gregory King. And you can imagine that my eyebrows were raised when that became clear. And there was some, in my early thinking about this, it crossed my mind that King might be encouraging him to do this. King works very actively on the Newdigate pedigree. King plans his mother's funeral in 1680. So King is pretty heavily involved. The less I think about that, the less likely it seems, really, given what we know about King's own interests in the early 1680s. And if anything, the way I think about it now, I would probably say the influence is more likely to have run the other way, from Newdigate to King. The other possibility, and this is hinted at in an amazing episode which is described on the final pages of the fifth volume of the survey, is that in very late 1684, Newdigate forces one of his tenants in chief, another gentleman who is a non-resident who holds property of him, freehold, forces him to perform the ancient ritual of homage, on his knees, with his hands together, kissing the landlord's feet. Now, people haven't been doing this on English manors for 300 years, pretty much. And Newdigate absolutely insists on putting this guy through that humiliation. And I don't think it's coincidental that that landlord had, or that landholder, had repeatedly obstructed Newdigate's desires to improve the estate, compounded by the fact that both of them were on opposite sides in the confessional and political debates of the 1640s and 50s. So Ward was from a royalist family, Newdigate from a parliamentarian family, and in fact, Newdigate's father was one of Cromwell's senior judges. So I just wonder whether there isn't a political dimension to this too.
That's fascinating. I think that maybe you could separate motivation from its uses.
Sure.
Sure. But in terms of the uses, definitely that dimension of social control that would chime with that customary ritual and the kind of active epistemological force of information gathering.
Well, thank you.
Question here. Can I just ask you, I'll seize the moment again, just to, for those of us who are not early modernists, It does occur to me that people in the modern period have an everyday life too. And I wondered whether, as you've been thinking about anxieties that have been prompted by your methods, whether you've got any observations looking forward to those who are attempting to do microhistories or whatever we want to call them, say, of the 20th century. What? I can think in the a lot of the work around the First World War, there are many community groups who are trying to do similar sorts of things. And I wonder what you'd like to say to them.
Well, interesting. I mean, I wouldn't discourage you, anybody, from wanting to do this kind of work because, as I think you can tell, it's very, very exciting. It's really exciting. At the same time, it's daunting, both in terms of gathering the data and in terms of analysing it. Several people have responded, as I've talked about this over the last few years. Somebody once said, Jesus, nobody does this kind of work anymore. You know, because it's just so labour intensive. And in the world of the RAF, it's very, very, this is obviously a long, long-term project about one very, very small place. And the logical counter-argument is, well, you need a research team. You need a whole series of people to work on this collectively. But it's interesting that nobody in this room says that this isn't worth doing, right? Or isn't worth attempting. And I am passionately committed to the idea that it is worth it because I think this level of observation discloses social and economic relations that would otherwise be completely invisible. And that's really the appeal of the project to me. And I'm sure that's true for the 20th century cases as for the 17th.
You never know, Steve. You haven't had the last of your questions. So would you like to ask?
No, sure. It's very enthusiastic. I, too, am not an early modernist, but your presentation reminded me of Valerie Kivilson's work, Cartographies of Tsardom, Land of Its Meaning in 17th Century Russia, in which she was also very lucky to have this extraordinarily rich collection of early modern maps. But she makes much more critical use of them, I think, because of course maps do not simply illustrate reality. They produce these meanings of land which can be contested and so on.
Exactly.
So I'm just wondering whether you could also be more critical in your treatment of maps and this kind of material.
Yes.
And perhaps you could, as she does, perhaps you could also include some court evidence for this or ecclesiastical evidence and so on.
Yes. So. Yes, I'm sure I could be more critical of the maps. What, actually, one of the things that really changed the way I thought about the significance of mapping was reading Jim Crace's extraordinary novel, Harvest. Has anybody read that? The scene in which the guy who's perambulated the parish for years, decades, generations, first sees a cartographic representation of the landscape that he knows only in sensory terms. It's absolutely extraordinary. And I do think that I could do much more with that, but I'm grateful for the reference. Thank you.
Keeping me Jodie fit here.
Yeah, I think Barry had a question as well. Hi, Barry.
Hi, I'm Agnes. I'm Agnes Arnold Forster at King's College London. And this isn't really a question, but more of sort of picking up on something you said that I found intriguing. And maybe that you could use this to map the sexual relations of a village or the sexual geography of a village. I love the idea of finding out where they were doing it, but probably can't actually.
I'm glad
do
you
it.
Put it in those terms.
But like, for example, the idea that there's only one illegitimate child in the village.
Or one recorded illegitimate child.
Or one surviving illegitimate child. And I think that I love, and the 6 week old baby.
Yeah.
That their parents married before the baby was conceived after.
Thank you. So one of the things that I haven't got round to doing yet is to calculate the bridal pregnancy rate for this village, because we know that bridal pregnancy was relatively common. Yeah. So I need to work intensively on the interval between marriage and baptism for those couples where I've got that data.
Yeah, and I know, I mean, so like Simon Schretter at Cambridge, all that kind of fertility stuff, I think is really...
But actually, one of the things... Sorry, I didn't mean to... One of the things that I got most interested in when I started to realise that the houses where children were being conceived and born, looking at the number of people who were already co-resident in the household and how many other children, whether there were servants, and what that might tell us about privacy or the lack of it. Mm.
Sorry, just an add-on question. Yeah. Are there animals? Does it record animals in the house?
No.
Just like, I wonder how many babies were killed by pigs and things like that.
Well, So farming animals, yes.
Let's hold on to that thought, shall we?
So yes, the probate inventories obviously include livestock. That's very significant. What they don't record is domestic pets. Bugger.
One of the room's Barry's.
Yeah. Sorry, Barry.
Barry.
It's Barry Dole. Ooh, Barry Dole from University of Huddersfield.
Can you shout a bit, Barry?
I'm obviously not working. Okay, my question is, what do you want to do with it? You've told us all the things you might not want to do. What's the thing that you really, really want to do with it?
Can you repeat the question?
Yes, so the question is, what do I really want to do with it? So if you'd have asked me this about a year ago, with the encouragement of various long-term fellows at the Huntington, I really was thinking I should write a million-word book about this place and just do it and literally unleash my inner Cowsabon. But no, seriously, I think there are probably two books here, actually. I think there is a hard hat, economic, demographic, geospatial analysis of the community that would appeal to a scholarly audience, principally of historical demographers and economic historians who are interested in labour markets and material culture and that kind of thing. And then there's a more general book which tells the stories of the households, but probably selectively. So to take the alehouse and tell the story of the alehouse, or to take the almshouse and tell the story of the almshouse through the lives of those individuals who lived there, which can be reconstructed. So that's the way I'm thinking at the moment. Does that sound plausible?
Yeah, what about a fictional account as well?
Oh, I haven't got a novel in me, no.
You don't have to have one, it's there.
Well.
You've just got to fill in the gaps.
Yeah. Thank you.
And one last question from Pam.
Hi, I'm Pam Cox, University of Essex. That's a fabulous Steve, so excited. But there's definitely a screenplay in it, The Widows of Wash Lane, which must star Olivia Colman.
Before you go any further, before you go any further, when I gave my first talk about this project during my interview at the Huntington in early January 2011, one of the people in the audience who turned out to be the Vice President for Communications at the Huntington said, well, the stories are so extraordinary and the characters are so vivid. Have you ever thought of talking to a screenwriter? And I said, well, let's face it, if I don't get this job, there'll always be the film right.
Well, my actual question was, people also talking now about the sensory turn in social history, and I love that I can hear the babies crying, I can smell the babies. How could you give us a sensory history of this place?
Pretty easily, I think, in some respects. So the auditory history, I think, is easiest to do, because you can imagine the hammering of the forges in the blacksmith's cottages. You can imagine there's so much metalworking going on here, and tool making. This is a clangy place, right? The fact that the tannery is right here, you know, that must have been a bit stinky. So you can do the olfactory stuff in some respects. And so on and so on and so on. One thing that bothers me is that I haven't got a sense of how wooded it is. So, were there any trees? No, just asking, you know. Yeah,
but on that, the burning historical question of the moment.
Obviously, can't see
where
the
are the trees, and can we map them? I mean, not unimportant. Environmental history, another adjective.
Yes.
So, I think that Steve has served us really well this afternoon. I think that you have really engaged, asked all sorts of interesting questions, and I think we ought to get some exercise by clapping, but in a moment go and begin our birthday reception, and which of course is accompanied by a drink, because one of the other senses that needs to be met, I think, is beginning to be awakened. So I think, can we thank Steve?
Thank you.